Listen.
Something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir.
Yes, it is the sweetest name.
Thank you for joining me on this program. This is Destiny International Christian Assembly, and I'm Pastor Jide with the Alternatives, bringing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, the gospel of the kingdom of God, directly into the comfort of your home. Thank you for connecting on a regular basis. We appreciate your love. Today, I want to begin a new teaching on the book of Habakkuk. And I want to do my best to make sure that we receive and we understand what God is telling us, even at such a time. The book of Habakkuk is a minor prophet in the Bible. He is one of those prophets that instead of speaking to people about God, he was lamenting about God, about the situation of the people to God. And that makes me to understand that, you know, so many of us throughout this year or whatever situation we have gone through, we are in that situation where sometimes we ask God questions, sometimes we see evil prevailing in the world, and so on and so forth, and we don't know what to do. Now, can God be good when life is not? This is the focus of Habakkuk. Can God be good when life is not good to you? How can we embrace God's goodness when we are in our lowest valley? When things are not working for you, when life is not pleasant, when circumstances are dominating you, when sickness, oppression, family struggle, economy challenge, business catastrophe, COVID-19, your business is not doing well, your health, your marriage, anything. How can you embrace God's goodness when you are in the valley? This is what we are going to be looking at. These are the questions I trust the Holy Spirit will give us answer to during this series of message by God's grace. And this is why I title it Hope in the Dark. There is hope in the dark. 2020 can simply be defined for me as an unprecedented year. With all its challenges, with all the struggles, with all that we had to face, then on top of that is COVID-19. And COVID-19 was not pleasant to anyone. People lost their jobs. People lost their income. People's life were taken, people died, members of family died, and so many, and so on, and so on. And even right now, as we are in December, there are still many that are feeling the effect. Maybe all of us, perhaps you, perhaps myself, we are still feeling the effect of COVID-19. Why will this happen to my family is the question many people are asking, or some people are asking. Why will this happen to me? Why will I have a child that is born with disability? Some people are asking this question. Why have I been married for so many years and still I don't have a child of my own? Why is it that I'm asking God for a wife or a husband and other people are getting married and it seems that for me, I just have to keep waiting and waiting? Why do I have to go through this sickness? The doctor says this, I prayed, I fasted. It seems God has done something, but this sickness or this disease had come back. Why do I have to have members of my family in this condition? I serve you, God. I worship you, God. I believe, Jesus, you are the Lord. I gave my life to you, and I trust that all things are possible in your name. But I've been praying about this situation concerning my children. I've been praying about this situation concerning my circumstances. I've been asking you, but God, it seems you are deaf. it seems you are not willing to answer me. Why? Habakkuk continues, say, why is injustice in my life? Why, our sister read in the Habakkuk chapter 1, why does the righteous people have to suffer the iniquity or the trouble that a sinner brings upon us? Why, God, and maybe you are here this morning, and this is what 2020 represents in your life, and I'm here to tell you that even though you are struggling and wrestling to understand, the word of the Lord for you is you still need to embrace His goodness. You still need to embrace His faithfulness. Because you will see at the end of this book that God will show you precisely what He wants to do in your life. Maybe you are here, you are tired. You have come to the situation where you just drag your feet to church. You just drag your feet to read the Bible in the morning. You just drag your feet to pray. You know God is there, but you're not feeling His presence. You know God is there, but why do you have to face these circumstances? When you're going back to Habakkuk, the book of Habakkuk, you find out that he was in a situation the same like you and I. This guy speaks to God on behalf of people rather than speaking to the people on behalf of God. And I find that very, very interesting because prophets are specifically called to hear from God and bring the word of God to the people, not to hear the complaint of man and take it back to God. He lamented. He understood that God is faithful. He understood that God can do anything. As a matter of fact, if you read chapter 1, God, I know you can do this, but why are you not doing it? And this is the situation, or maybe peradventure, this is the situation that some of us are facing. Your friends have taken you into a place where it's a place of, you know, abuse upon your life. You know, you have been misjudged, you have been mistreated, and your life so much. And these are the people perhaps we trust. These are the people perhaps we rely on. These are the people we esteem. And they have abused us, they have used us, they have done all kinds of things that you begin to ask the question, where is God? Where is God? Maybe you are here, maybe that's your situation. Maybe you are in the hospital bed right now and you've sent prayer requests, you've asked people to pray for you, you've prayed yourself. Maybe you are in the prison, maybe you are in your home. Maybe. There are questions in your heart you need to ask God. Now, other people have gone through similar things in the Bible. And the question that was on Habakkuk's mouth is this. He wanted to know why God doesn't seem to be fair. F-A-I-R. Why are you not fair? Why are the righteous suffering? Why are the evil people seems to be prospering? Anybody wants to agree with that, that you can see that around? That you're trying your best to do well, to serve God. And people who are not thinking of serving God, the hypocrites, the liars, it just seems that things are doing well in their life. Why God doesn't seem to be fair? He knows that God can do it, but he's not seeing it happen. In Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2, look at what it says here. How long, O Lord, how long? How long must I call for help? Is there anybody like that? Is there anyone like that? How long have I called, O Lord, for help? You said you are my helper. How long am I going to call for help? The Holy Spirit is my helper. How long am I going to care for? Are you really hearing me? Are you fair? Is this fair? How long? How long will I call for help? But you do not listen or cry out to you. I'm telling you violence. I'm telling you trouble. I'm telling you I can't take it anymore. But God, you do not save. And yet, we know that you are the Savior. We know that nothing is too hard for you to do. In verse 3, why do you make me look at injustice? Why do I have to go through this? You know how many people may be asking that question? You know how many followers of Jesus may be asking that question? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Why do you allow people to use me? Why do you allow people to abuse me? Why do you allow people to take advantage of advantage of me? Why, Lord? Why? And said, destruction and violence are before me. I can't see the hope in the dark. I can't see the end of the tunnel. Because this has been going on, and this is still going on, and it seems there is no end to the going on. Maybe that's the situation you are. Maybe that is the current situation in your life. Basically, he's asking God, why can't he help him out? The name Habakkuk means to embrace and to wrestle. That's the meaning of Habakkuk. So when I found out, I wanted to know the meaning of Habakkuk. I found out that it's from the root word to wrestle and embrace. You wrestling with God's faithfulness. You wrestling rather with the situation, the circumstances you are. You can't comprehend, you can't understand why this thing is happening. But at the same time, you're embracing God's goodness. I don't know why I'm going through this, but God, you are good. I don't know why this challenge continuously persists in my life, but God, you are good. He's wrestling with the situation. He's wrestling and struggling, and there seems to be no answer for why, but he's still embracing God's goodness. Listen to this. In one hand, we struggle. But God expects us, in another hand, to remember that he is good. That's why we sang that song this morning. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Now, to me, that's personal. That's personal. Because I know where I come from. I know where I'm going. And I know the challenges, the struggles that I go through. But God has been faithful in every step on the way. Is there someone here like that this morning? Or maybe you are watching and you don't seem to have answer to your situation. You love your spouse, but now you are divorced. You love your children, but now it's wandering away and your child seems to have gone and not returning again to Christ or to home. You had a good job and now that job has been snatched away from you. It was a dream job. It was a job you have given testimony about. It was a job you have given, maybe even sacrifice and give money and say, God, I thank you for this. But the job is taken away from you now. Or maybe because of one good thing you have done, somebody lied, and you are now in prison, or you are now lost your job, or something happened. For the good that you do, something negative come out of it. That was the cry of Habakkuk. Why do you allow the righteous to suffer? On top of all that, COVID-19 didn't help. He says, God, your faithfulness doesn't seem to be fair. You said you are faithful, but I cannot see in the midst of my struggles, I cannot see that faithfulness. But God, I want to embrace you. I can't understand, but I'm not going to go back, but I want to stay there. Are there people like that? I'm like that sometimes. I don't know about you. I have said many times, where I am is better than where you took me from. Amen? And whatever I'm going through now, it can only get better. I will rather stay with God than stay with man. I will rather stay with God than stay with man. That's why that song we sang again this morning, I'm desperate for your word. I'm lost without you. So we must understand that sometimes God doesn't seem to be fair. In verse 3, Habakkuk said, why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Give me verse 4. Now look at verse 4 now. Therefore, the law is paralyzed. In another word, Habakkuk is saying here, your word had no effect in my life. That's why I ask us to pray that prayer this morning. Thank you for your word. Because it's your word that saved me. Amen? It's your word that we are kept by. And we stand by your word. It's your word that brings provision. It's your word that brings guidance. It's your word that brings wisdom. Habakkuk said, your law is paralyzed. I look at your word, it has no effect. I look at your promises, it seems it's not working in my life. I quote, I cram, I recite, I memorize, but it seems it's not working. And there are people like that. There are people like that. And Habakkuk was speaking for them. He's telling God, number one, God, I don't really think you care. By allowing all these things to happen. Number two, God, I don't really think you are doing much about what is happening. Number one, I don't think you care. We don't say those words sometimes, but listen to me, we think those thoughts. We don't say those words sometimes, but we allow circumstances to give us that picture. If God cares, why is he allowing this? Number three, Habakkuk said, God, I don't think you are fair in the way you're dealing with me. Because when I look at other people's life, I don't see the same dealings. And yet, your word says, there is no, God is a God of equal. What's that scripture again? It deals with us the same way. Now, the message I want to present to us today is, is it okay for us to ask God questions? Crazy questions. I would rather ask God crazy questions than not asking him questions at all. I would rather ask God wild questions than abandoning his word. Than abandoning prayer, than an abandoning service in the kingdom of God. Now, you will understand that this is the same thing all over the Bible. You've heard about the lamentation of Jeremiah. Anybody has read the book of Lamentation? Always lamenting. God, why? 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 We've read it in the life, we saw this in the life of, in the book of Ecclesiastes. We saw it in the psalm. Mostly half of the psalm, or maybe more than half of the psalms, are asking God questions and finding out how to get out of a situation, inquiry and questioning and seeking answer from God from situation. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. He was embracing the goodness of God. Though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, it is struggling. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. But I go through the valley of the shadow of death. He's struggling. He's struggling between God's faithfulness and God allowing that situation to happen in his life. Jesus, the same thing on the night at the ninth hour, he cried out with a loud voice with the same question in Matthew chapter 27, verse 46. It says, Eli, 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 lama sabachthani, why have you forsaken me? So it's God, holy Jesus, without sin. He took our sin and we took his righteousness. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? So there are times in our life we need to ask this question. I have a slide I want to show us there in the next 10 minutes before we close. And this slide will explain some Christian journey that unless you embrace, it might be difficult for us to live a successful Christian life. Life seems to be good when you give your life to the Lord. All the promises vibrant, you are your expectation, and you are excited with God. Keep that slide on, and I want you to just focus on that slide for now. For those of you watching at home, I just want you to keep your eyes on that slide and see and allow God to speak to you. This sermon is not going to end today. You're not going to see the good part of this sermon today. You're not going to see the good part of this sermon next week. You might not see the good part of this sermon at the end of it. But when you, as we go through it and you allow God to minister to you, you will pick up what God wants to speak to you in Jesus' name. Amen? Then you feel you're on fire with God. You know, every sermon makes sense to you. Every song makes sense to you. You turn up your radio or you put a cassette or whatever. Cassette. Do you still use cassette today? You can see where I'm coming from, cassette. Why are you laughing, you? You don't even use CD today. What do they use today? Sorry? Whatever. You turn up your stereo. You don't even use stereo. What do you... You plug your iPhone. Well, you know what I'm talking about. You don't know. And you listen to worship music. It seems every music that you hear, God is speaking to you. Anybody has ever experienced that? You are on the up in your Christianity. You know, it's a graph that goes like this. You started there and you continue going up excited. Excited. God is faithful. You pray, it seems God answer. You're looking for a parking. Just Jesus, provide me a parking. He provides you a parking. You say, wow, God is good. All the time. Everything is going well. Then you come on top. You're on the mountain top. You want to go to church every day. If there is church service every day, you are the first to be there. What, pastor, we have church service in the morning. Why do you not have church service in the evening? You just want to serve God. You just want to be there in the presence of God. There is the fullness of joy. That's your language. Then when you are at the top there, then you begin to come down somehow. Somewhere along the way, something happened. You lost your joy. You lost your enthusiasm. You lost something. And you're on top of the graph, and all of a sudden, you know, you started like this, and then you stayed there for a while. And after some time, something begins to happen. That's why the Bible says in James, give me James chapter 1. James put it this way in verse 2. It says, why you are on top of the mountain and something happened to you. All of a sudden, you down. You bow your head. The excitement is gone. Jesus is, you're not hearing him again. His word is not exciting to you again. You don't pray as often as you used to pray. You dragging your feet. James says, consider it pure joy, my brother and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds. If you look at that graph again, that is, you are coming down fast on the mountain. James says, consider it pure joy. Now, what happened here is usually what I'm going to share with us today. There are three things that could happen here when you are considering it pure joy. There are three things that could happen. Number one, you could say, I don't want God again. I'm tired of this God. Can you take the slide away? I will call for it again. I don't want this joy. I don't want this God again. You know, God is not my situation again. And you push God aside. And you pray less. And you don't want God. You still call God. You still believe in God. But your language is changing. Your attitude is changing. Your demeanor is changing. Your life is changing. The excitement has gone. You've pushed God aside. The second thing that people can do is we can choose to go back to the world. The first one, you have not gone back to the world, but you are not cold and you are not hot. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But the second choice is, damn God, forget God. I don't care about God again. Let me go back to the world. Give me that slide. You go back to the bottom where you started. You go back to the world, the language of the world. You swearing, you cursing, you stealing, you cheating, you doing. You are no different than the people of the world because trouble has come. Challenges has come. God is good all the time. Where is the all the time? You wrestling, you struggling, but you're not embracing the goodness of God. And then you come down here. Give me James chapter 2 again, the next verse, in verse 4 or 3. It says, because you know that the testing of your faith produce perseverance. So you're on top of the mountain. You're coming down now. You made that choice that, okay, you know, I don't want God again. You're wrestling. James says, let that perseverance continue. Because what God wants to do is, give me that slide. What God wants to do is this. When you persevere, and it brings you in the midst of your trouble, listen to me, you don't see the light. You don't see hope in the darkness. You don't see the light at the end of the tunnel. You pray, you fast, things are coming down fast. James said, persevere. The trying of your faith. You're coming down, and you hit rock bottom. Now, give me verse 4, or verse 3 and 4 again. It says here, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, let perseverance finish its work. Let perseverance finish its work. Let perseverance finish its work. Now go back to the slide again, because what God wants to do in the midst of that perseverance is this. So you can be matured and complete. God allowed that struggle, challenges, difficulties, the things you could not explain, express, is building you up for maturity, is building you up to be complete. And then the latter verse of James says, so you will lack nothing. The third choice that people make is they wrestle. And this is where God wants us to be. We wrestle with God. We wrestle with the condition. We wrestle with the pain. We wrestle with everything that is going negative. But we hold on to the promises of God. We hold on to the promise. This is what Habakkuk was trying to tell us here. And I will show you maybe next week, maybe second service. I will speak more on that. Let me round up in this service. I read Psalm 23. And I said to myself, David was holding on to the goodness of God. But David was also struggling with the promises of God. And when I read that psalm, I found out that the way to know the faithfulness and the goodness of God is not when you are on the mountaintop. Did you understand what I said? The way to know the goodness and the faithfulness of God is not when we are on the mountaintop. The way to know the goodness of God is when we are going down and when we are at the bottom of the valley. David said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures." Everything is going well. Then in verse 4, it says, "All of a sudden, I found myself walking in the midst of darkness." But what I like in that scripture is, though I walk through, he's walking through. He's not meant to stay there. The challenges, the difficulties that you are going through today is not where you ought to be. It's because God is making something out of you, and he will finish what he has planned and purpose in your life in Jesus' name. You're watching online, you say, "Well, my struggle is too much. I can't take it anymore." If you are like that and you are not born again, I want you to give your life to the Lord. That's the starting place. That's the place to start. And once you start with that, you confess your sin, not to man, not to priest, not to bishop. You confess your sin to Jesus. You tell him what your struggles, and you trust him for salvation. And once you have given your life to the Lord, we want to hear from you so we can help you to grow in faith. Until next week, may the Lord bless you. Don't miss the series. We're going to continue next week, and I want you to connect with us because we're going places.
Listen. Something about the name Jesus.
Something about the name Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes, I say it is.